Hi everyone, I'm glad to be with you today. My name is Moulham Al-Roumi. Obviously, Christina worked a lot on the pronunciation of my name, especially my last name, but she did well. Everyone calling me Mo in society just to make their life easier, so you are, feel free to call whatever you prefer to do. I'm a father of two children. I moved to the States 3 years back, maybe, with my family, my wife and two children. Why? We will be talking about that during the discussion. I'm originally Syrian, and I'm still having the Syrian citizenship. And why I'm meeting with you today? Today we will be talking about the main things I think I represent somehow, or partially represent. So basically, I'm Middle Eastern. I'm an Arab. I'm Syrian, and I'm a Muslim. So I call these four sort of like the four scary stuff, you know? It's sort of scary in this society. Any of them would make some of the people uncomfortable or scared or feared, if I can say that, unfortunately. And that's maybe because of a lot of misunderstandings in the society about these things. So my goal today is just to discuss and talk and interact about these things, clarify some points, if any of you want to clarify some points. And I'll basically at the end also try to explain a little bit what's happening in Syria, because originally I'm Syrian and I feel obliged to talk about that. So mainly we're just discussing, it's more into discussion than lecturing. I'll be talking less and try to take more questions during the session as much as they can. And we don't have a lot of time, but we'll try to squeeze as much information as we can. So I think we have to start. We talked about who I am and why I'm here. And we mentioned the goals, but I want to talk about it more and more during this session. What I think about Islam, what you think about Islam, is totally different, obviously. But the goal is to clarify things that is misunderstood. I've got a lot of weird, if I can say, questions from a lot of people about my religion, about my background. Some of them are normal and logical. Some of them are absolutely illogical. So my goal is just to clarify these questions. I think asking is a blessing. When you ask about something, you just get more educated and more knowledgeable about it, and that's how you grow up your knowledge. That's how you think, in fact. You think based on the ideas you built all over the years. So let's start about talking about Islam. I started with it because it's the bigger group that I'm a part from. Muslims are around 1.2 billion all over the world. So it's kind of one-fifth of the world. If you're talking percentages, we're like 5-something billion. Muslims are 1.2 almost. They are concentrated basically in the Middle East somehow. There are a little Islam percentage in somewhere in the Far East also. The biggest Islamic country, maybe this information is shocking for some people, the biggest Islamic country population-wise is Indonesia. Not Saudi Arabia, for example. Not any Middle Eastern country, if we want to talk about it. So population-wise, the biggest Muslim country is Indonesia. Why I mentioned that? I mentioned that because of the stereotyping. When you see someone who look Middle Eastern, if I can say, or if I may say, then you immediately think he's a Muslim. I'm not saying this as a negative thing, but this is how we stereotype. This is how we are as human. We stereotype sometimes intentionally, but we do that. So, not all Muslims are Middle Eastern. Obviously, not all Middle Easterns are Muslims. Middle East, in fact, is, I would say it's a society with almost all the religions. We had a lot of, okay, it's mostly it's an Islamic majority, but we have Jewish, we have Christianity, we have non-believers, so it's kind of a mixture. So it's not really, they're not really tied together.
Basically. One of the first thing and the most important things I want to talk about it is the first 2 points. I'll try to merge it together. There's a lot of mutuals between Christianity and Islam, and that's something people don't notice that, especially in the West. Because whatever the ideas they are seeing from the media, or even in the society when you're talking to your cousin or you're talking to your friend, whatever information you get, usually, unfortunately, it's a negative thing. And obviously you don't want to link the negative thing to your background, so that's why anytime you talk about it, you say, no, Christianity is 10 times different, I want to say, about Islam, or there's nothing mutual. In fact, there are a lot of mutuals. If you want to dig into it, you will find a lot of mutuals. We are not really planning to talk about it today, because it's you can talk about it for hours and hours, but I just want to mention that, and if someone is interested, they can go into it and look into it. What's the mutual between the religions? And I just want to mention one small point. In fact, in Quran, there is a very, it's not very long, but it's a long, one of our long verses, and it's called Mary. And it's all about Mary and Jesus. Relation between religions in the Middle East is, so I would say Islam is 1,400 years. Well, Christianity is a little bit older. It's like 2,000 something years. Islam reached to the Middle East in general, spread in the Middle East almost 1,450 years on average. And let me go a little bit closer and talk specifically about Syria. In Syria, Islam came almost at the very beginning. And before that, Christianity was there. And for the last 1,400 years, these two religions were living in harmony. I would say full harmony, till maybe the last century, if I want to be clear. I would say the last century is the first century which brought some misunderstandings and less harmony between these religions. And I would be very accurate if I say that's only for political reasons, and only political reasons. In these societies, like I would take Damascus as an example, Damascus is one of the oldest inhabited cities in the world. In fact, it's the oldest inhabited capital in the world, and that's a scientific fact. You could check it out. And till today, and I would say till the first quarter of the last century, we have Jewish, in fact, living in Syria. We have streets still now called like Jewish Street or whatever Jewish turnpike or whatever, it's still there in Damascus and in the biggest cities in Syria. And the same applies in Christianity. For example, I'm from a city called Hama. It's somewhere in the middle of Syria. This city is, I call it one of the most conservative cities in Syria. So if you think Syria is conservative, this city is 10 times more conservative. And in fact, if you look at the map, in the middle of that city, there is a huge part, like a big circle in the big map. And this is the place that Christians live. How they merge, how they affect each other, more than you can think. So, for example, Muslims put the head cover or the headscarf, usually the ladies put that, and till really late of the last century, the Christians used to do that just because of the tradition. So it became a tradition more than being religious thing, because the Christian woman used to put the headscarf just because they are in a society. Obviously they are not forced, especially in the last century, but it's just a choice because they are used to being covered somehow in the society, and they are doing it. So this is just an example how these religions affected each other. I remember I was like 7 years old. And I was in a country called Lebanon, which is very close to Syria. It's a very, very small country. And I was riding a cab, which is a public cab, so you could drive with different people. It's not only you. I was, I think, 6 or 7. I don't really remember. I was with my mom. And the nun came to the car. And the moment she stepped in the car, she said, Assalamu alaikum. And I was like, what she's doing? Assalamu alaikum is a word that Muslims say when they greet each other. And the exact translation is peace be upon you. And I was like, mom, she just said Assalamu alaikum. She's obviously coming from the church. How did she do that? So I cannot remember that day, in fact, because this is how they affected each other. This is how simple the life were or was between them. And hopefully it will come back after what's happening in Syria now, and soon, hopefully. So I just want to mention these examples to show you that it's more traditional to be together than trying to affect each other than being more religious. That's number one. And number two, to show you that all the problems which is happening now is more political than being religious. And we will come into details during the discussion. Before I have a very inspiring video about this thing and how the religions have a lot of mutuals, but I want to take any questions there before we move to the video, before we end this chapter. Anyone want to clarify any point about this?
Well, that's very important.
I mean, I wish I'm that clear. Please.
You may be talking about this later, but within the Muslim community in Syria, are there Sunni and Shia?
Percentage wise?
Yeah.
No. It's a majority Sunni country.
And is that in part of the problem? As you just said, it wasn't a religious problem lately, but is that part of the problem?
It is part of the problem, in fact. It is part of the problem. In fact, the Shia Sunni thing in Syria is again very political, and that's because the government in Syria right now is considered somehow on the Shia parts. In fact, they claim to be Sunni. It's very complicated, but it is a part of that. And that's why you see a country like Iran get involved in Syria that strongly. Because the current government, which is a minority, population-wise, is considered on the Shia parts, and while the majority is Sunni. I'm not 100% accurate, but I would say it's like 70% Sunni Muslims, and we have like 10 to 12% Alawis, which is the current regime, and which again we consider a little bit more Shiite. And we have the rest is between Christians and Jewish. We have much less Jewish at the end of the last century, Jewish left, but the rest will be Christians. And we have some ethnies, which is really, really, really old in history, like Ashuris. Plus, we have some Armenian people that they came to Syria before. So it's a very, very big mixture in there. I wish my answer was clear enough.
That helps. Thank you.
Thank you. Please.
I don't know if you can add one thing. Concerning the Shia and Sunni issue, in the beginning of the history of Islam, there was not a religious conflict. In the beginning, it was political conflict. People had their own opinion about who's going to be the leader after the passing of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. But now it became more politicized to a point it's like a truly religious difference. So religion is being metamorphized by the political opinions, right? So, yeah. And just to add one thing, this is something I just encountered like before this session. I had a student with the name Khan, K-H-N, like Khan Academy, if you know who's Khan.
K-H-N.
Yes. K-H-N. It's a famous name in Pakistan and Southeast Asia. So to me, this student is Muslim or related to Islam somehow. But when I get to know her, she's a Christian. So her father is Pakistani Christian.
And I was like, yeah, I remember meeting, maybe in 2004, meeting a priest who came from where? Can you imagine from Afghanistan? So there are Christians in Afghanistan. Definitely there were Jews, or they have Jews in Afghanistan. So every single country, like every single Muslim country, you have minorities, religious minorities that are protected. And if you look at some of us in Muslim countries, like when I checked my lineages with my great-great parents, one of my great-great mothers came from a tribe that was a Jewish tribe, and there was intermarriage between Jews and Muslims, and usually it's a Muslim man marrying Jewish woman. Yeah, that's the usual.
Well, that applies, by the way, whatever Mr. Muhammad said, it applies on the whole Middle East, if I can say, and in fact, the whole Muslim country. They're always a very respected and protected minorities in these countries. Honestly, the Afghanistan information was new. I was thinking there's no Christians in Afghanistan, but I know that in the Middle East, or basically in the Levant countries, there were a very, very, very high percentage of Christians, like Lebanon, Syria, Iraq, and Jordan. These four countries are having a very, very high percentage of Christians. And we've been living together till the politics kicked in and start using these differences into their own benefit. I'll leave you for 3 minutes or 4 minutes maybe with this video about how mutual is the religion, especially Islam, Jewish, and Christianity. Let's look at this interesting video. But this experiment is the second version of the main experiment. In fact, the main experiment is an experiment they did in Germany, like 1 year and a half before. But because it's in German, and our German is not like very good, we shared this one. And honestly, I'll be very honest and open with you, there is another reason why we shared this one. So this video has been shot in Toronto, Canada. So it's called sort of the North American side, which is closer to us. Unfortunately, we don't have enough time. Otherwise, I would love to see three different videos about the same experiment, which has been done, one in Germany, one, which is this one in Canada, and one here in the United States, and see how different is the reactions between people based on their society and based on their background. It's called Bible versus Quran experiment. You could YouTube it, and you could see the whole three versions. There are more than three versions, but these three are the main, and you could figure it out from the views. So it would be lovely to see how different people in different societies react to something like that. Some societies, people could be more tough, and some societies could be more flexible in this. But the only reason why we shared this is to show that a lot of misunderstandings are there. Usually the media share the mad things about Islam, and don't ask me why, because I don't know. It's something happening since the second half of the last century. And it's just growing. It's a fact. Why? It could be very complicated to answer this question, but it's sort of what's happening. So why I always recommend my friends and people I met, like, if you need to know anything about any subject, it's always good to ask, it's always good to read, it's always good to educate yourself about it, then you can decide your own point of view. Don't copy others' point of view. If I came just now, I'm coming now to talk to you about something, don't copy my point of view. Just get educated and try to create your own point of view, but based on knowledge, not based on copying. That's the last part. Now we want to talk briefly about the Middle East as a region, as a geographic region. And the only small part I want to talk about it, the only small point I want to talk about it is stereotyping that we mentioned at the beginning. I just want to talk more. What's our general concept about the Middle East? If I told you draw a picture from the Middle East, what would you draw? Any suggestions?
obviously all of you know the picture, but no one has the courage to say it.
Please. Don't draw a camel.
A camel. Exactly. A camel, maybe a tent. Now, maybe if you if you want to go a little bit farther, you would put a gun near the camel.
Desert.
Maybe.
Desert.
A desert.
Pyramids.
You're highly educated to say pyramids. You're very liberal to say pyramids. But that's absolutely right. So yeah, a desert, a tent maybe, a camel. That's it. Maybe a woman, fully covered.
Good food.
Good food. So, in general, our understanding of the Middle East is very, I want to say narrow, if I can say. It's a little bit narrow. And we have this same little thing that we look at, and we ignore the other things. So, the Middle East, talking about the desert, for example. Not the whole Middle East is desert. Mr. Muhammad is from Morocco. Morocco has a desert. They are having great coasts. They are having high mountains, right? They're having a lot of greens in Agadir. So, and Syria, the same thing. In fact, Syria, we have less desert than they have. But again, it's not only desert. So we could always look, search, and see. Number two, the woman with that cover, or fully covered, that we always say in KSA, for example. This is not general in all Middle East. And in fact, it's not even general in all Muslims. Some Muslims, some lady Muslims, are not even having a headscarf. Some of them are having. Some of them are having the headscarf without the cover. When it comes to face cover, by the way, it's a little bit critical. It's a point of view thing, because a lot of Muslims think it's not a mandatory thing, it's just the headscarf is the mandatory thing, and I'm one of them. Some Muslims think women should cover their faces. I don't agree with that, I don't think that's accurate, but I respect their point of view. So, I said Lebanon before at the beginning, and I want to go back to Lebanon. This sentence is 100% accurate. Some parts of Lebanon is really much more liberal than the States. And I mean it. So the Middle East is a mixture. A lot of Muslims, a lot of Christians, some Jewish. Even Muslims between themselves are different parts, different ways of understanding the religion. Just like anything, just like any subject, you always have different parts of different ways of understanding it. It depends on your background and how you see things. So, as we mentioned, then I'll take again Damascus as an example, just because it's a whole city and because it's my capital. In Damascus, you walk in the streets, you see people with their face covered. You see ladies with only scarf. You see ladies with shorts. That's very normal. So you see everything. And I think Morocco applies the same thing exactly. I never been a lot in Morocco, but I went to Casablanca, the same thing. You see ladies with very, very tiny shorts and very widely open t-shirts. And you see ladies with maybe their face covered. So it's just the only thing, I just want to make less stereotyping. I want to encourage everyone to go Google or look about more information, more pictures, more sceneries from the Middle East, so you have a less narrow understanding of the Middle East, if I may say. Please.
Yeah, I'm aware of Morocco and Lebanon, because I have friends from there. But I'm curious, do some of the Middle East countries besides Saudi Arabia have laws about whether the women need to be covered or not?
Thanks for the question. It's a point I wanted to say and I forgot about, so thanks for reminding me. I mentioned KSA here for a reason. I have a lot of respect to this country. I've been there multiple times. One thing I want to mention, not defending them, but I just want to mention as a matter of fact, ladies in Saudi Arabia, I wish I was born like a lady in Saudi Arabia, because she got treated like a queen on the side. But again, Saudi Arabia is the only country that have regulations to force women to not drive or to wear the head cover.
And I don't think there's any Muslim country other than Saudi Arabia who does that. And that's why I mentioned with PSK. So I'm not trying to defend them, and at the same time, I'm not trying to attack them. Because I've seen a lot of examples how great they are with their women. And it comes to the same point we talked about a few seconds ago, how traditions are sometimes going more than the religion. So it's traditional for them that women is not driving, and it's very tough now to implement it. It's kind of a legalization thing, a traditional thing more than religious, because that's the thing. When Prophet Muhammad came, or when Islam came, there was no cars. So we can't say that Islam eliminated women from driving a car. In fact, this morning I just read a title, I couldn't read the article in The Independent. You could Google it. The Independent is a British newspaper. I just read the title of an article. A full female crew landed their plane in a country that the woman is not allowed to drive. In fact, a crew from, I think it's from Malaysia, Malaysian Airlines, sent the full female crew to land in Saudi Arabia. You could Google also the article if you're interested.
I have a question.
Please.
Do you know what is the reference in the Quran? Why do women are supposed to cover their head? What is the basis in the Quran? What does it say?
Why the reason? What's the reason?
Does it give a reason, or does it just say women should keep their head covered?
It just gives a reason, a general reason. I'm not so much deep into that, so I don't want to say something I'm not really familiar with by details. But the simple explanation of that in the Quran.
We like simple. Simple is good.
Exactly. So the simple explanation from Quran is less attractive to men. When she put the head cover, she's less attractive to men. And that makes less problems, if I may say it as simple as this.
I understand that.
Yeah. Why you want to make a woman less attractive to men?
If, that makes sense to me too, but depending upon the hairstyles. Come on! Just look around!
I think if Mr. Muhammad can help me.
I just want to add a little. First of all, the tradition before Islam was that women mostly used to cover.
So it was a tradition.
Before Islam, it was like, which means in Saudi Arabia or Middle East, what religion was their practice before Islam? It was Christianity and Judaism. So if we go to the Old Testament and New Testament, it talks about, even in Judaism, women are discouraged to uncover their hair. So for a woman to uncover her hair, the Old Testament says she should shave her head and wear a wig. And it's in the book.
Yeah, that's
all the right. Anyways, so when Islam came, did not deny the other religions, because as a Muslim, what I believe is all the Abrahamic religions, they came from the same God. People misunderstood them or misinterpreted them or did not practice them fully. Islam is the last memo from God to humanity. So when I practice something, I can find a relation from my practice to Christianity or Judaism. Except you have to look deep or dig deep in the book to find that practice. And the reason is, first of all, not to make, we have majority women here. I mean, women that do not react to seeing the other gender the same way as men. You're a scientist, you know this, right? So, in the Quran it says...
I know.
But one thing in Islam recognized human nature.
Physiology.
And acknowledge it, but what it does not oppress it. No, it try to educate it, right? Like, as a human being, when you're young, you don't have too much responsibility. If you're a man or a woman, you don't have too much responsibility in covering, but you learn how to mature into your religion. So when you are an adult, you are able to assume your responsibility and your duties as believing and practicing man or woman. So, long story short, the practice of hijab or headscarf was pre-Islam, And it was like the free woman, because we know slavery was practiced all over the world, especially also in the Middle East. The free woman used to cover, but their slaves, their servants, were uncovered. So that's another thing to...
Please.
Yeah, first, I love that
English, though.
You're doing very well.
I think every religion has the same policy about the hair, the especially woman's hair. Because, you know, the nun in Catholic, nun covered their hair, and the Buddhism, you know, they cut all the hair, their hair. Islam, although religion has been changed with history and the time. But I think head cover is not important thing, but it is a representative to representative how Muslim Islam keep their position or Quran the learning.
Yeah.
How to get keep their learning of
In fact, there is a very important point in what you say. There is two points I want to mention before we close this chapter. Number one, thanks to Mama for helping me explaining this point. It's a kind of sensitive point, by the way, because for me, I don't want to go deep into the religious thing if I don't have the accurate explanation, because I might cause a misunderstanding, which I don't want. But thanks a lot. There is one important point. He went so far when he talked about before Islam, so 1,500 years before. Who raised in a Catholic house?
You.
What about your mother when she went to church?
We all Catholic. She used to all Catholic were used to
Yes, we did.
But also,
Mary did.
As you said, which is very, very accurate, I think, times are changing. My mother told me stuff that nowadays, I don't think was accurate. And I think she was a little bit too conservative. Okay, a long time ago in the 1900s, women couldn't even vote, you know?
So, the woman vote, by the way.
By the way, today is the night, right? So yesterday was
International Woman's Day.
International Woman's Day.
We should
all
stay
home.
Yeah. Oh, it's
even
without women, we can't do that.
Someone did.
Life will stop with
so you should be equal and you should work. the only thing I want to mention here, that the point that you say is that Islam has less changes than the other religions. And one of the main reasons for this, by the way, is the Holy Book. Now, the Bible has a lot of versions, while the Quran is still the same exactly as it came 1,400 years before. So I wouldn't say that the religion will change, I would say the understanding will change. Number two, you mentioned that your mother told you to stop. So that's maybe after 2,000 years of Christianity. Let's wait after 2,000 years of Islam. Maybe the mothers will tell their daughters to stop, which I doubt it. But I mean, the understanding is different. Your mother changed her mind, not because of Christianity changed. Society changed a little bit.
Society changed.
But the religion is still the same. And the nuns are still having this. Still
some
today.
Nuns, not all of them, some nuns.
Most of them.
No,
the Catholic?
Not most of them.
Not most of them?
But
yeah.
Some of them do.
Yeah, please.
So that's an interesting point, because the Bible has been translated a lot and from the original tongue, and parts of the Bible are in sometimes different tongues. different languages actually sometimes. So is the Quran, the version of the Quran that most people use, is that the original, is still in the original language of when the Quran was first
written? There's only one version of the Quran, and that's the only difference between Quran or Torah or Bible. There's only one version, it's exactly the same as it was. People, like, for example, if you could find an English version of Quran, but a lot of people who convert to Islam or they are Muslims and they don't speak their language, most of them they learn Arabic, just to avoid this misunderstanding or mistranslation. But there are versions in all languages, but I see that a lot of Muslims I meet in the different non-Arabic speaker, they try to learn Arabic just because of this. While the translated version is available, but a lot of people try to avoid any misunderstanding or mistranslation by learning the language.
By reading it in the original.
Right, exactly.
So, is the language enough the same that there are misunderstandings because the language itself has changed over time? Because language doesn't stay the same.
The spoken language in Arabic, the spoken language has changed a lot. And that's why I have a different dialect than Mr. Muhammad, just because we're from different countries. If we want to understand each other, that's very easy. We talk the formal Arabic, which didn't change much, by the way.
So, but you both can read the Quran in the original.
Exactly. Because we both can speak the formal Arabic, while the spoken Arabic, the spoken dialect might be different in Morocco, than Syria, than Egypt, than any of the. But the, I would say the formal language is still almost the same, identical. It's a very powerful language. I'm not here to talk about Arabic, but it's a very, very, very powerful language. And the number of words is like 4 or 5 times more than the second language. It's the top language with the amount of words. So we have like, I'll give you just 2 or 3 examples from the top of my head. We have like almost 30 words for love. The levels of love. We have like 30 different words with different meanings.
Almost how many names for wine are there in Arabic? Even though as Muslims we don't drink, but in the culture, there are a lot of words for wine. I was
plus, for example, rain. We have like, I would say maybe 20 words explaining rain. Now, is it a must or a mandatory that me and Mr. Muhammad, as normal people who are doing a different field than Arabic, know them? Not really, but there are. So the language is very, 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 very rich. And that's why maybe it didn't change a lot, because it's not in the developing section. It's not developing anymore. It was like sort of in a very stable condition when Quran came. And it's almost the same now. Yeah, it's almost the same. Any question before we move to another point? Now we're moving to the last point, or sort of the last point, Syrian conflict. Who can tell me what's happening in Syria right now? In few words, I would take something from any student, please. If anyone knows what's happening in Syria, please.
Civil war.
Any other answer? Civil war. Between who? Do you have any idea who is the parties? I mean, anyone has a different answer? Or a different understanding? No. Okay. I will tell you the answers I've heard. I've heard it's ISIS versus people. I've heard it's civil war. I've heard it's a religious thing, so it's Muslims versus Christians. I've heard a lot of explanations, and I'm sorry to say none of them are accurate. To know what's happening in Syria, I'll go back 6 years in time. And I'll just tell you briefly how it started, how it developed, and how did we reach to where we are now. Why I'm telling you this, because the last point we'll be talking about is the refugees. And without knowing what's happening in Syria, you cannot understand the refugee crisis. In Syria 6 years ago, the people started demonstrating against the government. And when I say the people, I mean everyone. Christians, Muslim, non-religious people. It was government versus people. And the state, as a peaceful demonstration against the regime for almost 1 year and a half, almost. Now, the dates are not really accurate because, in fact, on the ground in Syria, nothing is accurate. I have more knowledge because I have my contacts in different parties. I know what's happening, but if you bring someone from CNN, maybe you don't have an accurate dates or numbers, or because, in fact, it's not really shared. And it's having a different point of view. So I'll give you just a general understanding. So people started demonstrating against the government, and that because Syria is very, 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 the government in Syria is very, 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 very strict and tough. And there's no liberty in the society, there is no human rights, there is no freedom of speech, there is nothing of what you Americans think it's a normal thing. Freedom of speech is your right. It's not even a normal thing, it's your right. Being free to believe whatever you want, or to think whatever you want, or to say whatever you want, is your right. We have nothing like that in Syria. So people start demonstrating, asking for their right, their civil rights. They're asking to have a civil community, a civil society. They're asking for their freedom. They're asking for their freedom of speech, even freedom of religion, by the way. That stayed as a peaceful demonstration for almost 1 year and a half. In this 1 year and a half, the government were killing people right and left, just trying to kill what's happening. Now, I just want to mention that the government is almost a 60 years government right now, or a little bit less, maybe 50-something, because the dad was the father of the current president, was a president for almost 40 years. Then when he died, they put the son, and the son is now for 15 years. They are from a minority called Alawis, that we talked at the beginning, they are leaning towards Shiites. They claim to be Sunnis, again for political reasons, just because they want to rule the country of a Sunnis majority, but in fact the reality is totally different, everyone knows it. It's not the main reason, because there is no real problem between Shiites and Sunnis, but they're using this to control the people. They're using this to have the power. They're using this to stay on the chair of the ruling the country. After 1 year and a half, and these people getting killed right and left just because they're having a sign asking for freedom or for right or whatever, a lot of the people in the army, they started to run away from the army because the orders are coming like, go to that street and kill everyone demonstrating. So this guy from the army might have his cousin or brother or father or mother or sister or whatever in those people. So a lot of people started to run away with their guns and try to defend the people demonstrating, which is their families. And that is the beginning of the development. So now there is something has been created called the Free Army, which is people from the real army running away because they don't want to kill their people, trying to stand on the people's side, trying to defend them, and now we have two people with guns. Is anyone in Syria wanted that? I don't think so. Is anyone in Syria planning to do this? No. But the amount of killing, even in the first, I don't have accurate numbers, but thousands and thousands of people got killed in this 1 year and a half administration. Now, when we have two parties with guns, things goes a little bit out of control and the chaos started. After that, a lot of the countries who has interest in Syria got involved. And here when things developed so radically. Until now, by the way, we are almost in the third year. There is no ISIS, there is no extremism, it's just people versus government. Till now. Russia interfered, Iran interfered, so the Persians interfered with the government. And some of the Shiites' background from Lebanon interfered with the government. A lot of the other countries, the powerful countries in the world, Russia, America, China, got involved somehow in the conflict. And they started empowering the parties. The regime has much less support in the international society. And his only exit is to make it extremism versus government, or versus liberal government.
And that's when he released all the extreme people from his presence and told them to go away. He didn't plan it. Or at least it seems that he didn't plan it. But this is exactly what he did. All the extreme people that they're in jails from 30 years, from 20 years, people who went to jail like 15 or 20 years, now they are 50. He just released them. Go away, you're free to go. And now this is what happened. That's how ISIS got created, almost 3 years after the Syrian revolution started. And now ISIS is, everyone knows what's happening here with ISIS. But now, as a Syrian citizen, my biggest problem is not ISIS believing me. If I'm in Syria, if I'm inside Syria, my biggest problem is not ISIS. I have like six or seven other problems. I have the regime, I have the Russian airlines that they're striking every now and then, randomly, sort of. Sometimes I have the American army, who is trying to protect some of the stuff. I have a lot of people trying to kill me before ISIS. ISIS is one of them. How to solve the problem? I don't want to take much time because some people maybe have something. How to solve the problem? It's very simple. If the government people problem got solved, which is the main reason of what we are, if you eliminate the main reason, the small things will be eliminated. Is it that simple? No, it's not. Because every day it goes further, the solution will be longer. But you have to understand that the Syrian people in general, they are liberal. Even the Muslim part of that, even the extremism, if I can say it, extreme Muslims, still they are liberal somehow. And none of them accept what ISIS is doing. None of them adopt their ISIS ideology or ideas or concept or way of understanding Islam. So I think if you solve the problem between people and the government, ISIS, eliminating ISIS will be much easier because you're not using the power now from outside, you're using the power of people who are living on the ground. Please.
Thank you for your explanations. I got a little bit confused when you said the regime, I'm assuming Assad, wanted to set up this polarity between liberal and extreme. I don't understand how releasing the people from jail helped that. I got confused there.
Yeah, I'm sorry, maybe I was not clear enough. Now he needs an excuse. After this, after the United Nations and the international society started attacking them and criticizing them, like, why are you killing your people? Why? And when, in fact, the states, Obama said a few years back that the state will get involved, will eliminate Assad in a few days, and that's it. And the idea was there, in fact, in the states. And in another country also, Russia was saying that it will interfere and eliminate everyone and keep Assad by himself, maybe. But a lot of people got involved, but in fact, the reality, he needs an excuse. And his only excuse is by making it look like civil war. Or making it look like it's ISIS versus the people, or ISIS versus the government. So it's kind of manipulating the international society's mind and point of view. And let me be honest with you, it worked. This guy's a genius. It worked very well. Now the states is not really involving very, very well, either Obama administration or even Trump administration, and that's because they are scared. What if we eliminated Assad? Who will stop ISIS? He was very smart in doing this. I think Assad created ISIS, indirectly, but intentionally. And he did that just to stay on the chair. People like this, I'm not really coming to implement my point of view on Assad to you guys. It's just my personal point of view. But this is what happened. So I'll tell you the facts, and you guys may your own understanding. This is exactly what happened. It's an excuse for him to kill. Sorry to say that. It's a powerful word, but this is what's happening. We almost lost a million people, maybe, so far. A little bit more. We move to the last point that I want to talk about, please, which is the refugees crisis. Why people are fleeing their country? I think we already talked about that. They are facing tons of danger things. One of them is ISIS. There are a lot of other things. Situation in Syria are very, 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 very tough now. No electricity, no water. You sit in your house with your children, you don't know when the bomb will come, and you don't know from who. You really don't know from who.
You don't know who killed you. Now what's happening in Syria now? In fact, what's happening in Syria 4 or 5 years ago still was a huge massacre will happen somewhere. And everyone will claim that, no, I didn't do that. The regime did that. And the other party will claim the same thing. No one knows what's happening. So that's why people are fleeing their country, because it's not even impossible or possible. It's impossible to live there. It's almost not possible to live. And that's why they are fleeing, and that's why they are running to another place. The last point I want to talk about, I think we took a long time. The last point I want to talk about is very important because it's touching all of us. The refugee crisis is huge. It's worldwide. It's dangerous. I can agree, especially in Europe, because people are fleeing in high numbers without any documentation. You don't know who's coming and who is not. And I understand anything coming in Europe to eliminate that. Going to the States, I cannot accept, I cannot understand any refugee elimination or stopping laws. Why? And that's the important part. What's happening in the States, there is only two ways for a refugee to come to the States. My way or the other way. So my way is, some people are using it, to be honest. My way is, if you can get a visa to the States, which I did, it's a tourist visa. I got it for me and for my family. And when I came here, my situation is a little bit complicated, but I'm just giving you a general example. For me, I got forced to ask for asylum. Well, usually people could use the way that they come and just come as tourists and they ask for asylum. So this is the first way. Second way is the people that the government is bringing from the nearby countries, like Jordan. There's not a lot of in Iraq, but in Iraq, Turkey, and Lebanon. And those are people the government, the American government, is choosing and bringing to the States. Any one of you knows how long this process takes?
2 or 3 years.
Exactly. It's a process of 2 or 3 years of vetting, investigating. It's almost involving all our national security administrations. CIA, FBI, all our national security administrations are involved in this. It's a process of 2 or 3 years. Usually they bring kids, sick people, people over 50s, or a young man who's having like 10 children or more. Usually these people are vetted, very well vetted. They know everything about them, and they are having their documentation. By the way, just to let you know, America refused to take anyone without any documentation, by the way. Because they say to the United Nations from the very beginning, if you have anyone without documentation, just don't put them on our list, that list that we're taking. So everyone is documented, vetted very well, and came here. I don't think they're listening, number one. The other way is the way I did, which is a visa. You're American citizens, I vet all of you. You don't know what's the meaning of American visa. American visa is a very, very, very complicated process. It takes a long time. It's not easy to get. She's laughing because maybe she's struggling to get it. And the lady before, she's laughing. So I bet you she struggled. This is a fact. It's not something easy. And again, there are the same process of vetting happening. It takes less than 2 or 3 years, but it's the same process of vetting on each and every person coming to the States. Why I say that? Just to eliminate the fear. One of the last small points I want to mention before we end with a little video. What's the type of refugees coming to the state? Not all the refugees are poor. Not all the refugees are not educated. Some of them are coming with millions of dollars they want to invest here. He is running for a place for his family. He's not coming to take your welfare. He's coming with tons of money. He's coming to pay taxes, but he needs a safe place to leave his children in. That's an example. The other example is highly educated people. Some of them are doctors, some of them are nurses, some of them are engineers. And again, these people are not coming to depend on the society. In fact, these people are coming to be part of the society, to be involved in the society, to do their part, to work, to pay their taxes, and to be citizens after a long, difficult process. But this is something I think everyone should open his eyes on. Not all refugees are coming
to get the AB visa and stay home, I bet you there's a very little number, if you count a big number, of refugees coming to the state, at least specifically from Syria in the current days. We will end with a very, very short video, a few minutes also, and this will show you what's happening in Syria, and it will show you some sad images about how Syria was and how it became. I cannot say enjoy the video because it's not a lot of joy, honestly. I don't know if anyone is having a question. I wish I was clear enough in my delivering my point, clarifying some of the misunderstandings, which is about my background. And guess what? We're all still alive. You met the Syrian, Arab, Middle Eastern, Muslim, and he's still alive.
Thank you very much.
That's a privilege. Thank you. Thank you.